started over a century ago for an iconic trophy, first awarded in 1909. Winnipeg and Montreal have each won it many times, but they've never had to face each other to get it. Until now. The Blue Bombers are back in this game for a fourth straight time, with memories of winning it here in Hamilton just 2 years ago. The Alouettes have waited 13 years, but they have the memory of dominating a 16-2 favorite just last week. Welcome to Grey Cup 110 on TSN. The Bombers and the Alouettes. And on the toss, it was Montreal winning it and deferring to the second half. So there's Jenerian Grant, the leading returner in Grey Cup history. Back with Johnny Augustine to get Grey Cup 110 underway here at Tim Hortons Field in Hamilton. Off the foot of David Côté, Jenerian Grant has it. Goes to his right. And Tyrell Richards in on the tackle. So Zach Caleros comes in, Glenn Suter. A record, four straight Grey Cup appearances starts for a quarterback.
The first one back when Zach was a member of the Hamilton Tiger Cats, of course, the last three with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. The wrong end of the scoreboard last year by 1 point, but they are back. They are a battle-tested playoff team, a battle-tested Grey Cup team, and definitely have the edge tonight in experience.
This is his fifth Grey Cup start for Zach Caleros. Had one with Hamilton back in 2014. First down, first play from scrimmage. There's a handoff to the leading rusher in the Canadian Football League and the most outstanding Canadian, Brady Oliveira.
Great offensive line with tremendous experience up front for Winnipeg. They're led by Jamarcus Hardrick, who was a finalist for the outstanding offensive lineman in the league and a CFL All-Star. And Brady Oliveira led the league in rushing by a long shot, over 400 yards. And Dalton Schoen, CFL All-Star, who hasn't played since October 6th, was a game-time decision. He's good to go.
That's a big surprise, given how little he's practiced the last month and a half. So off the second and five, it's complete. It's a first down. That one is caught by Nick Dembski, who had over 1,000 yards receiving, taken down by the Alouettes' Darnell Sankey.
Well, I mentioned that the Bombers are the most battle-tested Grey Cup team in this matchup, but they're not the healthiest of the two teams. Nick Dembski also nicked over the last couple of weeks with an ankle issue. Looks pretty good on this curl.
Gain of seven for Nick Dembski. He got over 1,000. Brady Oliveira getting over 1,000 on the ground. Remarkable Canadian talent on this Winnipeg team. They've been there before. First and 10, Montreal 53. Handing off again, Oliveira. And he breaks a tackle and he pushes his way down with a little help inside the Alouette 45. Oliveira, to start the game against BC last week, they gave BC's defense a steady diet at number 20.
Well, he was a free agent to start the season, but in July, late July, the Montreal Alouettes acquired Sean Lemon, and he just went ahead and led the team in sacks throughout the regular season. They also added Darnell Sankey in the middle of their defense, the middle linebacker, in September. What a difference maker he has been. And Mr. Turnover, Marc-Antoine Ducroix, out of the University of Montreal. Boy, he can take the ball away. He's done it. He set the tone in the Eastern Final against Toronto. He has been a beast back there at safety.
That pick six last week set the tone for that game. So here we go on a first down. It is back to Oliveira, and this time the Alouettes do a better job with it. The rookie Lual Ugoak in on the tackle as they limit the damage for Oliveira that time.
Well, interesting, similar start for Winnipeg offensively from the West Final. They wanted to set the tone in that game against the BC Lions with Brady Oliveira. He went 70 yards. It was all Oliveira, and they were up 7-0 after the first series. They're trying to start with that same approach and getting Oliveira engaged early, but Montreal has something to say about it.
They do, and the Alouettes defense was tested last week. Great down inside the 10, and then they got that pick six. It changed everything. Second and seven. Clarence throwing again, and he completes it too. That is Dalton Schoen, the top receiver on the Blue Bombers this season. And as said, we did not expect him to play in this game. Didn't practice at all this week leading up.
No, he hasn't been on the practice field or played in a game since back in October 6th. But, man, are they happy to have him back. And I'm sure Bomber fans are, too. Over 1,200 yards on the season. That ranked third in the Canadian Football League with 71 catches. And if you take a look at those 30-plus yard catches, those are the big plays. He had 11 of them.
26 touchdowns in 2 years, Clint. And last year, he had 3 catches against the Argos for 78. He was the rookie of the year in 2022. Back to Oliveira. Cuts it back to the right. Finds some room. Brady Oliveira keeps going. Running well, just like last week against the Lions in the Western Final. 14 more yards as he gets a first down inside the Alouette 20.
During the regular season for Oliveira, he had over 1,500 yards rushing. He can play the power game from tackle to tackle, or he's got the quick feet and speed and the ability to redirect and play in space as well. There's some tremendous cuts on this run. Get a new set of downs. Best run so far of the night for Oliveira.
From the Alouette 19, 6 offensive linemen in now for Winnipeg. Looking to start the way they did 1 week ago.
What is that?
It's the sweep. The Nick Dembski gets tripped up. Sean Lemon made contact with Dembski as he gets taken down right around the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, Sean Lemon played the play. This is film study. That's what this does. When Sean Lemon sees this, he uses his experience. He sees the action. This is the action we've seen before from the Winnipeg Blue Bombers to have Dembski wide. He cuts across the formation, but that penetration up the field from Sean Lemon stops the play in its tracks.
Bombers moving impressively in this opening drive of the 2023 Grey Cup. Down to the 20, but it's a 2nd and 11. Polaris with time. He completes it to Dembski, but he is tackled there by Reggie Stubblefield, who had 11 tackles last week in the Eastern Final. And the field goal unit will have to come on for the Bombers.
Well, nominee for outstanding rookie for the Montreal Alouettes. And what an Eastern Final he had against Toronto. Was all over the field. You mentioned the 11 defensive tackles. Almost a Winnipeg Blue Bomber before the season. But decided to go back with a couple of injuries. And he has played tremendous down the stretch.
Sergio Castillo was 5 for 5 in the field goal department here at Tim Hortons Field 2 years ago for Winnipeg. Looking to keep the perfection going now as it's put down by Jamison Sheehan. And right through, perfect it is for the first points on the board in Grey Cup 110. So it's Cody Fajardo's turn in his first Grey Cup start. The Alouettes down 3, about to get the ball for the first time. A look at the Alouettes' road to the Grey Cup, 11-7. Glenn, they didn't beat any team above them in the standings until last week when they not only won, but 38-17, a 21-point victory over the Argos.
A 16-win Toronto Argonaut football team with a whole bunch of award winners, including the MOP, Chad Kelly. They upset the Argos in that Eastern Final. Great play defensively.
First Grey Cup start for Cody Fajardo. And he is handing off to William Standback, left side. 2 years ago, the leading rusher in the CFL. But Cody Fajardo does have a Grey Cup ring with the Argonauts as a backup back in 2017.
First start, though, in the Grey Cup, and played in a couple of Western Finals as the starting quarterback for the Saskatchewan Roughriders, and almost retired from the game when he left Saskatchewan last year. But when Jason Moss was signed as the head coach in Montreal, Jason Moss always had Cody Fajardo's back, and he signed immediately.
The leader in completion percentage this season, Fajardo, with time. And a passing down at 2nd and 7. Jackson Jeffco chasing him, can't get him. Oh, nearly intercepted. Evan Holm was coming in. One of the leaders of that defense this year, and defensive plays, and nearly had a big one for Winnipeg.
Well, in the pass breakup department, he really led the way this season with 12 knockdowns. and has tremendous closing speed, maybe the best in the league at that halfback position, and making up ground in a hurry.
Joseph Zima from Melbourne, Australia, is the punter for Montreal. Janarian Grant is back for the Blue Bombers. The Alouettes do kick it away. Takes it off the hop at the 40. A punt of only 28 yards for Zima, who led the CFL in net punting yards, but better field position for Winnipeg to work with early in this Grey Cup with a three-point lead on TSN. Winnipeg back in the Grey Cup for a fourth straight time after finishing up 14-4. Brady Oliveira, big part of that.
Mentioned almost 400 yards ahead of second place Kevin Brown in the for the rushing title this season. Was named the CFL's Outstanding Canadian, but was also the West nominee for Outstanding Player. I mentioned that went to Chad Kelly, the starting quarterback for the Argos.
Long.
Winnipeg's opening drive went for nine plays, 48 yards to set up a field goal. Here they go now on first and 10 from their 44. Kolaris off to the right. That is caught by Oliveira. Catches a few as well as he gets it up across the 50 and a second down coming up.
Well, what they do in this, and we haven't seen much of this all season, all through the regular season anyway, that Brady Oliveira lines up at a wide receiver, and what it does for Zach Kolaris is to give him an early read on what Montreal is doing defensively. If they bring a linebacker out to cover Oliveira, then they're in man. If they don't, they're in zone. So when they saw, and Zach Kolaris saw zone, he threw it out there to Oliveira.
Great running back, but he does have almost 500 yards receiving on the year. That was a gain of 8. Short yardage, Dakota Prukop, who not only gets the first down, but several yards more as a little pushing and shoving ensues. Prukop had 2 rushing touchdowns in short yardage for Winnipeg in last year's Grey Cup against the Argos.
1,534 yards rushing, 9 touchdowns, almost a 6-yard average, the second best rushing season for a Canadian in CFL history. John Cornish had the big 1,800 year. Just an outstanding season and over 2,000 yards from scrimmage for number 20.
What an impressive year. He had 109 last week in the Western Final against BC. Back in his hands now on a first down as the Alouettes try to stuff that up. Once again, Dick Dembski, excuse me, the ball carrier. And just like we'll see Oliveira catching passes, we will see Dembski time to time running.
Yeah, little change up. And, you know, last week in the Western Final for Brady Oliveira, 100 yards came in the first half of that game. And the BC Lions made some adjustments in the second defensively. You can bet that Noel Thorpe and the Montreal defense watched the second half of that Western Final and studied it hard.
Over here. Go! What is that?
Second and 8. Of Grey Cup 110 and another big first down for Winnipeg.
Well, in the second half of the Western Final, when the BC Lions made an adjustment to stop the run and try to control Brady Oliveira, that's when Kenny Lawler got going in the second half.
They work tempo and hand it off to Oliveira again. He has room. Winnipeg's offense moving this football early on in this Grey Cup game, certainly testing the Alouette defense. Close to, and yes, it is another first down for the Bombers.
Yeah, I mentioned the offensive line being an experienced group. Watch Stanley Bryant with a big down block to open it up on the left side for Oliveira.
Kolaris under pressure and taken down. Sean Lemon gets the sack. His third Grey Cup sack. His first was 9 years ago when he took down Zach Kolaris back when it was Calgary against Hamilton.
Well, and really unblocked off the edge. You see Jamarcus Hardrick that's going to go down inside. So they leave Sean Lemon. Now, he thought there might be something up like a screen play, so he slow plays it, but works his way back to Brady or to Zach Kolaris to register sack in the Grey Cup.
That makes it second and long right now. He's back at the 14. This Alouette defense is certainly bending, trying not to break. Here we go. Kolaris with lots of time with only a 3-man rush. And looks to be taking off. Flying all the time he can. He finally does move and pick up a couple back to the original line of scrimmage. But a flag comes. looks like a hit to the head. Tyrese Beverett with his hands up. But what a penalty this would be against the Alouettes when it looked like they had Kolaris locked up and would be left for a field goal try.
Well, I think this is going to be against Mustafa Johnson, who in pursuit brought the big right arm right across the head of Zach Kolaris. Now, he doesn't have the protection of the pocket.
Major foul on necessary roughness. Control number 94. Half the distance goal. Automatic first down.
He scrambled and was well outside the pocket and really classified as a runner here, but it doesn't matter if it's a runner. You can't come across with the forearm to the head. Very close on Mustafa Johnson, but gives the Bombers a new set of downs.
They get the ball at the Montreal 5. Really backing up the Alouettes now, Winnipeg. Got a field goal in the first possession. Trying to find the end zone now in a first and goal. Oliveira, 3-2-1, touchdown! The CFL's leading rusher has the first touchdown of this Grey Cup. Brady Oliveira. And a two-score lead now for Winnipeg.
Well, taking nothing away from the Bomber drive, a couple of Brady Oliveira runs. This a real big one down the goal line to finish the drive. A nice catch by Kenny Lawler on it, but I'll just say a questionable call against Mustafa Johnson to give the Bombers a new set of downs in that situation.
An eight-play drive covering 66 yards, and that Bomber offense in tune right now. Two possessions. They've scored twice. Castillo for the point after try to make it a 10-point lead. And the other thing you think about, too, here is time of possession. We got only 2:40 left in this first quarter, and the Bombers have had the ball most of that time. He's had the ball a lot. Brady Oliveira, touchdown.
In a world.
Drive, impressive work by that offense. That big play to Kenny Lawler certainly helping out. And then Brady Oliveira ultimately gets his first Grey Cup touchdown.
And this is the call I would say is questionable, in that first contact looked like the shoulder pad, not the helmet. But that takes nothing away from an eight-play, 66-yard drive that took up 4 minutes of this first quarter.
So the Alouettes in a hole in this game. Tyson Philpott and James Letcher, the explosive rookie, to kickoff return for a touchdown last week in Toronto in the Eastern Final. And it is Letcher getting the football at the 10. And he is taken down just across the 30 for Cody Fajardo to come back on. You're watching Grey Cup 110. Tim Horton. First quarter dominated by Winnipeg. They've held the ball most of the time. It's Montreal football to start their second possession for Cody Fajardo in a 10-point hole right now.
319!
The fake to Williams stand back, and it is off to Tyson Philpott for his first Grey Cup catch. And Philpott across the 40 and close to a first down for the Alouettes as we take a look at their offense.
Well, Christian Matt, the only player on the Alouettes starting lineups that was in that 2010 Grey Cup championship back 13 years ago, along with Anthony Calvillo, and he's been the best receiver in this group and one of the top receivers in the league. Austin Mack had an outstanding rookie season, led in pretty much every category for this Montreal Alouette football team. Just a great year for Austin Mack out of Ohio State.
So that catch by Philpott, first completion for Fajardo, goes for 9.5 yards or more. It is second and inches, and the short yardage quarterback Caleb Evans has come into this game. And he does have indeed enough. Get it up around the 45 to move the sticks.
It's time to settle old scores and fight against the ultimate threat in Call of Duty Modern Warfare 3. Available now. Rated M for mature.
First down for this Alouettes offense, expected to be tested against a Winnipeg defense that was so good against them in the regular season. Didn't allow them to get an offensive touchdown in those two games. Right up at the Alouette 47, Fajardo. Little pump fake. Looking deep over the middle. It is caught. Oh, what a brilliant catch by the rookie
the Giants or now with the Montreal Alouettes, every coach he's ever had is that he is a tough, you know what, over the middle. I mean, this guy has got strong hands. He'll make the contested catch. He is not afraid of contact. Every one of his coaches at every level say one of the toughest receivers they've worked with.
I said rookie, technically first-year CFL player, Austin Mack. What an impression he's made.
Side of the formation, their offensive left to get some blocking help for William Stanback.
The play is under review by the command center.
800 yards rushing in the regular season, a 5.4 yard average. They brought in some blocking help, got some fullback blocking help to the left side, and he just hit it.
Now, you heard the referee Tim Croker say it is under review. That'd be the question. Was there a knee down before the ball broke the plane? They did signal touchdown.
Tough to see from that angle. We'll take a look. This should be a good one. A little blocked by the official. Every scoring play is automatically reviewed.
That is close.
Yeah, and the ruling on the field is touchdown. Therefore, they'd have to see enough evidence to overturn that. You just can't see his knee from that angle.
William Stanback had only 15 yards carrying against the Argos last week in that Eastern Final. He had a lot more success when they threw the ball to him and got him in space on screen passes, but busting off a big run there. And he has that game breaker capability. We've seen that. Led the CFL in rushing yards well over 1,000 back in 2021.
I don't know about you, partner, but I haven't seen any angle that would give you enough evidence to say that the ruling on the field should be overturned.
Two big plays, 31 to Austin Mack, a 32-yard run by William Stanback. Does it stand as a touchdown?
After automatic review by the command center, the ruling on the field stands. It's a touchdown.
First touchdown of the year for the Alouettes offense against Winnipeg. As said, they were shut out in that department in two regular season games, and what a time for it. Pending the extra point to get it back within a field goal. David Côté, his third year out of the University of Laval, with Joseph Zima holding. Explosive plays, longer drives by the Bombers. Just a four-play, 77-yard drive by the Montreal Alouettes. Back they came. Three-point game heading into quarter number two. Been dominated by Winnipeg, but that Alouette offense, when they really needed it, charged back in a quick drive to cut it back to a field goal.
Well, you see the 32-yard run by Stanback for the touchdown. That was a big one. The catch by Austin Mack. And in that first quarter, Brady Olivera with 42 yards rushing. So both backs prominent in this game, but a lot of the people that were making, you know, their picks for this game or what we're talking about, could the Montreal Alouettes keep pace offensively? You see how quickly they can score when they've got talent like William Stanback and Austin Mack in their lineup.
Well, they didn't need their offense to be explosive last week in the Eastern Final just because their defense forced 9 turnovers and they got a special teams touchdown as well. Defense scoring too, but yeah, you're right. They need their offense in this one to keep pace with Kolaris and Winnipeg. It looked very impressive. You saw the time of possession too, over 11 minutes of that 15-minute quarter held by Winnipeg's offense. And they're about to get the ball back to Cote to kick it off. 10-7 game, quarter number two begin. Jadarian Grant. Grant, who missed several games, just returned a few weeks ago. Have another look at that touchdown and how things opened up.
Well, just just up here is fullback Tuck, and this is Snead, the receiver, who's going to get the kickout block here at Stanback with that extra blocking help to the left side of the formation. James Tuck with a nice block down. Snead with the block and the seal up front. Tuck got to the second level as well on Kyrie Wilson. And William Stanback took care of business. The receivers got to get their nose dirty every now and then, and this is Tyler Snead stepping up with a nice kick-out block on linebacker Kyrie Wilson to spring his tailback.
Not the biggest guy. He's always had that stigma, Tyler Snead, but they say he's one of the toughest receivers going. And you're right, doesn't mind getting his nose dirty at all. So here we go, the toss inside. Nick Dembski picks up about three more, getting up near the 35. He has some tough sledding inside against that Alouettes defensive front.
Well, it's a defense that not only can stop you, they allow just under 200 yards in that Eastern final, but it's a defense that can score. Mark Antoine DeQuad, the
Xerox
safety spot.
Right. 64 Ohio.
Big interception in the Eastern final.
Ohio State swing on one. Ready?
That one set the tone on the Argos' first drive, and then later, second half, KB on Ento. Their field corner had a pick six.
Eight turnovers in that game.
What is that?
Remarkable dominance. Here we go, second and six. Oh, that could have been picked. First you saw the Wild come in front of it, and then Marc-Antoine Ducroix.
It was close. It was almost like he heard us talking about him, and he steps up. But, yeah, they'll move. Marc-Antoine Ducroix, the safety, they'll move him around and bring him up to the line of scrimmage. He'll come down and play in the box and try to rob these crossers, and that one just about picked off. Took a similar one to the house against Winnipeg in the regular season. Very similar play to that one.
He intercepted Kolaris three times in the two regular season games total. Including that one, as you talked about, for a touchdown. They're against the wind. You can see the difference on the punt. That one, a 36-yarder for Jamison Sheehan. Here's James Letcher trying to find the edge and trying to stay in bounds, but he does not. But Letcher has shown his explosive side. He's had returns for touchdowns on kickoffs, missed field goals, and punts.
Another game-time decision for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers defensively was their leader at middle linebacker, Adam Bighill. Tested it about an hour before the game, was trying to run a little bit yesterday in practice. We weren't sure if he was going to start tonight, but he has started in the middle of that defense, led the team in defensive tackles, with 74 on the season, four quarterback sacks, but it's his leadership that they'd miss if he wasn't in there.
Bombers really kept us guessing right up until game time with Bighill and Dalton Schoen. Both in this game at the Alouette 45, 10-7. Oh, big play defensively. Bodie Fajardo, gets taken down by Jake Thomas.
This is what the bookends for the Bombers on defense can do to you. Jackson Jeffcoat and Willie Jefferson, when they get up the field, there's one over here and one on this side. It's a tough decision for Cody Fajardo. Do I give it to Snead on this fly sweep? Nope, the defensive end's got him. That's Jeffcoat. So he keeps it, takes it up for a short gain, and tackled there by Jake Thomas.
We talked about Adam Bighill, the surprise, but here he is, and you saw him favoring that leg again after this play.
Well, this is the question. You wonder, it was a calf issue, and
Adam Bighill getting attention on the field. Back in a moment, Agri Hill and Dalton Schoen. Let's go down to Claire Hanna.
Head coach Mike O'Shea says he never wants to rule the player out until the last possible minute because he wants to give them hope that they might be able to play. And he sure waited until the 11th hour here at the Grey Cup, as neither Dalton Schoen nor Adam Bighill even took warm-ups. But what changed for Adam Bighill was on Friday morning, he got some intensive care on his left calf, his right calf, pardon me.
Deep ball there, Claire.
And what after Friday, as you were mentioning. On Saturday, he was testing out some sprints, and when he went back into the locker room, he had a look on his face that said, I can play. Now, for Dalton Schoen, they were more confident that he might be able to play in today's game because the joke in the locker room has been that he has been living and sleeping in their training room, doing everything to get ready, but he has not practiced since before October 6th, but it all paid off as he is in the game tonight.
Two surprises, although Adam Big Hill, you're right, getting some attention now on the bench. So that pass intended for Tyler Sneap was incomplete. Joseph Zeman again after the second two and out for the Alouette offense in this game. Zeman from the 40. And that one, a little shorter as well. It sails out of bounds in the air, and that is a penalty. Can't do that unless it's inside the 15. So that works against the Alouettes. Zeman is third year in the Canadian Football League.
Now, Rod, when you have great returners in the game like we do, and Janarian Grant on one side and James Letcher.
Punt out of bounds. Montreal number 36. It's a 10-yard penalty. First down, Winnipeg.
You have great returners like Letcher and Janarian Grant. I'll tell you what, that's where punters get a little worried. They're trying to angle it out and get it into the corner, try to get as deep as they can and close to the sideline. So there's not much space to return. Sometimes you can shank one.
Well, that's a net of just 12 yards for the net punting leader in the CFL this year. Up near the 50 for Columbus. Well, they've got heat on him again. They have him taken down. It's a Grey Cup sack for Mustafa Johnson.
Just a straight bull rush for Mustafa Johnson out of Colorado. Eastern All-Star this year, and it's just three-man push with the added being Darnell Sankey stepping up to eat up one of the blocks, but just tremendous strength and power from Johnson on the bull rush against an All-Star at center in Chris Kolinkowski.
Mustafa Johnson. Great game last week, too, in the East Final. And that victory over Toronto, second and 17 on that loss. From the Winnipeg 41, Polaris. They send only three again, so he has time. Rolling to the right. Down it goes. Into coverage. It's caught. Oh, what a big catch by Kenny Lawler with a couple of Alouettes nearby. And he threads the needle to 89.
You know, when you talk to Kolaris all season long, he will tell you he'll take the one-on-one matchup, and it doesn't matter who's playing defensively. In fact, he'll take one-on-two matchups when it comes to 89. He gives him a chance, and he comes up with it.
42, back to the ground. Brady Oliveira left side. Ball comes out. Alouettes have it. Waiting for the signal. Down at the 20, and a big break for the Alouettes there, too, forcing that turnover. They forced a bunch of them last week in Toronto, and they take over now. Oliveira had a great, great cup so far, but that gets stripped away by Kavion Ento. Montreal football down 10-7. Cody Fajardo about to get working with the Alouettes again. Let's get out of Matthew Shinetti.
Cody Fajardo hasn't seen his family in a long time, Rod, and he came to a new team, has led them to a Grey Cup, and someone who can understand that, four-time Grey Cup champion Ricky Ray, who roomed with Fajardo when Fajardo was his backup in 2017 with the Argos, as you mentioned before. Ray has been texting Fajardo all season. He texted him in the East Final, and he said, listen, you're 2-0. He's been keeping tabs on Cody, and this week Cody Fajardo went to Ricky Ray, who started in five Grey Cups, and asked him for his advice. Well, what did Ricky Ray say to him before Fajardo's first start? Don't put too much pressure on yourself. Act like you've been here your whole life. You've played enough games. When the ball gets kicked off, it's football. Wise words from a champion, Rob.
Absolutely, Matthew. Ricky Ray certainly knows. There's a pick to stand back. And with time, throws it off to the right. It is caught down around the 35 to Austin Mack, who had a big catch in the first quarter.
Check out some great route running against the leader in the league in interceptions in Demario Houston. He's going to get Demario turned upfield as if he's going to go deep, and then he comes back to that out right on the sideline, and Fajardo throws it low and away where only Matt can get it.
Gain of 14. First and 10 at the Alouette 34 now. A three-point difference in this game. 9:48 and counting until halftime. Quickly.
He can't go forward.
That is caught by Cole Speaker. He's got a catch and a Grey Cup, and he gets it up across the 40. It'll be a second and short coming up.
Take a look at the career of Cody Fajardo when it comes to the postseason in the playoffs. Mention the two West Finals, both against Winnipeg as the starter for the Saskatchewan Rough Riders. And Riders decided to go in a different direction. Cody Fajardo almost retired.
It took Jason Moss going to Montreal to influence that decision. Handing off left side. Williams stand back up around the 45. That is enough to move those sticks again for the Alouettes.
The difference between Oliveira and Williams Standback is it looks like they're different style running backs, but they're really not. They're both so versatile. Both can hit it up in the middle and play the physical game, and they both have the foot speed to bounce it outside. And for Standback, he's worked really hard this year catching the football out of the backfield. We will see some of that tonight, I'm sure.
First and 10, Alouettes down a field goal at their 45. Taking to stand back again. Willie Jefferson has tracked down Cody Fajardo. And Jefferson, Grey Cup veteran, has another Grey Cup sack.
Most teams, Rod, have to play this type of play with two guys. They have to play with a run stopper in here and then a guy in contain outside. Two players. The Bombers defensively, Richie Hall's group, don't have to do it when they have Willie Jefferson. He can play in the run lane and then still redirect with great speed to get to the quarterback if he pulls it. And that's exactly what Willie Jefferson does here to track down Fajardo.
And Fajardo knows him all so well back in the Riders rivalry with the Bombers. They set up a screen to the fullback, James Cup. He gets up and he picks up some more yardage there after the loss, getting it back to the original line of scrimmage where it'll be third down. Janarian Grant, as mentioned before, the leader in Grey Cup history in return yards. He had a big one to start the fourth quarter against the Argos last year in that crazy final quarter of Grey Cup 109. He passed the legendary Henry Gizmo Williams in total return yardage with that touchdown return over 100 yards a year ago. Zima with the punt. Had difficulty in the punting department, and this one that sails inside the 25, a 42-yarder for Grant. And works his way up a little bit more before he gets it across the 30. Back in Hamilton, 10-7, Bombers lead it as the second quarter rolls on. Two first possessions. Right down the field went Winnipeg. First for a field goal, then a touchdown by Brady Oliveira. But the Alouettes came back in a quick drive just at the end of the first quarter to make it 10-7. First and 10 from the Winnipeg 32. And it is Oliveira, the ball carrier. And picking up a couple more upwards of the 35. Story he's been. Top Canadian, most outstanding Canadian in 2023, and the Western nominee for most outstanding player. That went to Chad Kelly of the Argos.
Hey, Xerox left exit cluster. 764 jet backside paint escape. Check. I'm all ready. Yeah, good.
Blue Bombers are 6-for-8 in second downs. They have one here, a second and 7, up at the 35. We're showing pressure, but they drop off with time. Caleros deep over the middle, and it was Kavion Ento to get his hand on it, intended for Rasheed Bailey. Ento, one of the big plays by that Alouette defense last week when he intercepted Chad Kelly for a touchdown.
Inside motion, and they're going to try to hold the safety, Dacroix, with a straight seam route from Nick Dembski. Nice knockdown there down the field. Again, this Montreal defense starting to look like it did in the Eastern Final.
Second straight 2-0 Winnipeg. Jamison Sheehan with the punt. Low end over end for James Letcher. And he'll pick it off the hop. And he loses the ball. Mike Benson, the long snapper, comes in alertly and falls on it. So this time the Alouettes turn it over. And the Bombers are in business right around the Alouette 30.
Yeah, Letcher a little unsure. It bounces backwards. He picks it up, tries to tuck it in the left hand, and it is stripped. Benson picks it up. Clean recovery. No question about the fumble. That was Brandon Alexander on the cover teams that came down and got the right hand on there and stripped it out of Letcher's left arm.
The great safety for Winnipeg and great on teams as well on that play. Stripping it from Letcher. And the first turnover committed by the Alouettes. It sets up Kolaris and the Bombers at the Montreal 29 after they'd gone 2-0. But now in scoring range with a 3-point lead. And 5:23 to glow in the clock until halftime, and we see the challenge flag out in the hands of Montreal head coach Jason Moss.
Well, I didn't think there was any question that it was stripped out of there.
Montreal is challenging the previous play for no yards. The play will be reviewed.
Which is challengeable, so clearly Jason Moss felt the same about the fact that this ball was stripped, but was there someone within the 5 yards? Very close there. Letcher picks it up just past the 40-yard line.
Look like suits the only chance to be Kerfala Exume, number 39, the ex-Alouette.
Or Alexander. It's a halo that goes all the way around the returner, so it's not just the guys in directly in front of him. But again, I'm not sure that there's enough there to overturn it.
What a big challenge it is, too, late in this first half. A field goal difference in this game. And Winnipeg set up nicely to add to their lead if the call stands. Here's the referee, Tim Croker.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Montreal, a losing count, has lost a timeout. First down, Winnipeg.
Alert play, Brandon Alexander coming in, stripping the ball from James Letcher, and Mike Benson falls on it to give Winnipeg the football back.
Jason Moss will lose his timeout because he lost the challenge. I think it was a good challenge. I mean, it was close. And with the turnover and the great field position for Zach Kolaris, not a bad idea to give it a shot, but there wasn't enough there.
All right, here we go, inside the 30. Faking to Nick Dembski. Looking deep. End zone! Just knocked away! And a good defensive play for the Alouettes. Kabion Ento, the field corner, in coverage on Drew Wolitarski, the intended receiver.
Boy, Ento goes after this football and just gathers himself in time. So one-on-one down the field. Watch how he has to react back to the football. Turn inside out. And just get his hands on it. It looked like Wolitarski got in behind him by a yard. But Ento adjusted and got the tip.
Second and 10 now. Under 5 to go till halftime. Kolaris hits complete. A first down for Winnipeg. Dalton Schoen has his second catch of this Grey Cup.
I just wonder how limited Dalton Schoen really is. Gutting it out for the championship, and I don't blame him. Well, let's take a look at the throw and catch. Real nice pocket for Kolaris. He lets it go, and the inside route for Schoen just blocking out the defender in Wesley Sutton.
Their top receiver hasn't played since October 6th with an ankle injury. Was not expected to play today.
Go.
Another catch for him, and on the ground, Brady Olivera down inside the five. It'll be first and goal for the Blue Bombers. And what a first half Olivera's having.
Just a great jump cut by Brady Olivera. And how about the block? And there's a block here. Block right on Sean Lemon. Big on big there. And Brady Olivera with a jump cut back to the backside A-gap, which is the gap between the center and the guard on the backside. And Olivera with those quick feet. Big gain and a first down inside the five.
Nine carries, 69 yards. He already has his first Grey Cup touchdown. That came back in the first quarter. And we're in Olivera country right now again. Keeping it, Dakota Brukhoff. And Marc-Antoine Dacroix is not looking to let him get in the end zone. As hard as Brukhoff is trying, and gets it very close down to the one.
Interesting to see where they spot this, because Dacroix was trying to pull Prukop back from the line of scrimmage. He catches him about the 2 yard line, and then Prukop falls forward. So where are they going to mark this one? Because he falls forward almost to the goal line. Right on the one, looks
ball,
like.
Ball spotted right at that 1 yard line. Dakota Prukop, Winnipeg's short yardage specialist. In this situation, last year he had 2 touchdowns. Trying for another here, he gets it. Dakota Prukop finds the end zone again in a Grey Cup game as the Blue Bombers add to their lead. And that turnover, very costly for Montreal.
Got to take advantage of momentum and sudden change. That's what it's called. And in sudden change on the turnover, you want to go and score and keep building on that momentum. Really nice run by Brady Olivera to set up this short yardage play. And the Bombers have been excellent in third and short. Over 80% success rate. And they score here. And Brady Olivera blocking Dacroix off the edge.
Five plays and the 29 yards set up nicely after the fumble by Letcher. It was stripped by Brandon Alexander, and they go into the end zone. Castilla the point after try now. Just under 3 minutes to go until halftime of Grey Cup 110 here in Hamilton. Restored again for Winnipeg. Prukop with the touchdown and a 17-7 lead.
Looking this forward to a halftime show was when Shania Twain.
Oh, yes.
Across the snow in Ottawa was awesome. Green Day at halftime. Can't wait.
That'll be great. Looking forward to it. Still not done this half, though. Winnipeg's added to the lead. Down the west. Quick touchdown drive that needs a pass now with Letcher. Looking to a toe after the fumble. He goes back. He heads right. Trying to get around Evan Holm. He cuts inside. And he takes off and has a good return. Letcher up to the Alouette 50 and still plenty of time. Down the 10 points. 2:42 on the clock until halftime.
We love it when these returners in the Canadian Football League make the big play and get to the end zone. But this is equally as important. A good return to about midfield after a Bomber score to try and grab a little of that momentum back is super important for Cody Fajardo on the offense. Nick Hallett just out of his reach. Boy, he's made some big plays in big games.
He sure has. Their special teams tackles leader had a blocked punt for a touchdown last week against BC. The movement is Jackson Jackcoat runs into the backfield saying he was drawn as the flags come out.
And notice that Adam Big Hill is back at middle linebacker for the Bombers on defense.
Big Hill, a surprise starter.
Offside. Winnipeg number 94. It's a 5 yard penalty. Remains first down.
Jackson Jeffcoat doesn't get the call he was looking for, but mentioning Big Hill, a surprise with that calf injury last week. We didn't expect him to be in this game. He did. He had to leave for a while with that injury aggravated, but seems to be fine now. A first and five now, right at midfield for Cody Fajardo. Williams stand back, had a big run in the first quarter, but he has nothing there. He is stock cold, and it'll be a second and five to go.
This is a great play by Ricky Walker, defensive tackle for the Bombers, working against Justin Lawrence. Big number nine right in here is going to go right to the gap that this design play is to get to, and that keeps Stanback bouncing back there and can't get any downfield momentum. Number nine, plug that hole.
Second clock, quickly off to the left, complete for a first down to Austin Mack. He's had a good half in his first Grey Cup. Third catch for him at that big 31-yarder to help set up that touchdown in the first quarter.
Well, it's best against best out here. There's Austin Mack, the best for the Alouettes in the receiving core against Demario Houston up there at corner, who had seven picks on the season. He'll give a couple of catches to 81, but you know, 35s might have something to say before this one's over.
Mack's first game in the CFL against Ottawa, he had four catches for 120 yards. With a great first impression. Fifth in the CFL in receiving yards. Here's Fajardo now on first down. Throwing again inside the 40. It is caught. And Tyler Snead takes a pop, but he hangs on.
Love this play call here to Jason Moss, the former quarterback. He knows he's got a quarterback with great athletic ability. And Cody Fajardo, he's going to get him out and outside of the pocket. Get him on the run. Change the launch point. Get him out there. I know it cuts the field off for some of his receivers. He's got Snead on the curl. But Cody Fajardo has run for over 100 yards in the two playoff games. He can get outside and put the defense in a bind.
Exactly 10 yards and a first down inside the Winnipeg 40. Here come the Alouettes now on the first down. And off again, complete. Tyson Philpott with it. And after the catch, two good work by this second-year player out of the University of Calgary to give another first down to that Alouette offense.
Philpott, top of that stack receiver formation to the left side. He's just going to run the quick curl, and he can do so much damage after the fact. They love to throw the bubble screens to Philpott.
East nominee for most outstanding rookie last season. Here we go. Quickly up again to Philpott.
Yeah, that was the bubble screen, Rod, but it didn't work because the fake didn't happen. One of the two went the wrong way, either Fajardo or Stanback. That took the timing away, and the play just didn't have that same zip to it. So the ball didn't get out there to Philpott in time for him to make a move, but that's a great open field tackle. We mentioned Houston might have something to say yet.
Yeah. The 26 now. We'll see. Second and nine. Lots of time. Good protection. Wide open. Caught. Oh, what a play by Snead to bounce off the tackle and set up a first and goal for the Alouettes. In his first year out of East Carolina, Tyson's Tyler Snead.
Tyler Snead is going to be this deep dig route, and he makes a nice move to get home. Twisted, and once home is twisted and now having to do a blind turn to try to catch him, Fajardo has lots of time again, changing the launch point subtly, moving out of the pocket just a little bit to get himself some more time. He finds 85.
What Jason Moss loves so much about Snead is his toughness. For a smaller receiver, first and goal from the three, stand back. Breaks one, gets down near the one, doesn't break the plane, but it'll get them that much closer on a second and goal coming up.
A great response from Montreal to get down here to the goal line after the Bombers score with under 3 minutes to go in the half. I mean, this is... Now that final yard is the hardest yard on the field, especially when you're playing against the Bomber defense.
And Caleb Evans, like Dakota Brukoff, likes being in these situations for that hardest yard. Evans is in again here in short yardage. Scored a bunch of touchdowns for Ottawa last year. Rushing, Yeah, from Montreal, his first year with the Alouettes. His time now, Caleb Evans, left side, no.
No shot.
No, he did not get into the end zone there.
Jake Thomas, Jackson Jeffcoat. Good push. He wants to just go to the left side of the formation a little bit there. But I believe it was Jackson Jeffcoat that got the best push.
He got the push. You saw Brandon Alexander coming around as well to wrap up Evans. But you're right. He had nowhere to go. Straight ahead or just veering off to the left. So here we go. Third and goal. Alouettes down 10. Looking for a touchdown or bust here. From the Winnipeg 1, Caleb Evans. Left side again. They say no.
No signal.
No signal. And it looks like a turnover on downs.
Have a good angle for it. Potential
play is under review by Command Center.
Thank you. Every potential scoring play or scoring play is automatically reviewed, but ruled that they didn't get in on third down. And under review, they're going to have to see a shot of the football and whether or not it crossed the plane. So far, I haven't seen one.
That ball just needs to get across the front part of that goal line, but tough to say. You see Shane Gauthier in there.
Laval product stepping up for helping out for Adam Big Hill. Again, Jackson Jeffcoat got a good push once more on that side of the formation.
So they say under review, the Bomber offense is out, looking like a turnover on downs, and what a stand for the Winnipeg defense with just seconds to go until halftime.
Well, it's monster. I mean, two cracks at it from the one-yard line with a chance to make this a three-point game going in at the half and really take back the momentum. And no, sir. I think it is Shane Gauthier that is the first contact. Little help from Malik Clements.
Didn't look like he crossed the front plane. Here's the official announcement.
After review by the Command Center, the ruling on the field stands. First down, Winnipeg.
So the Alouettes got close. But there's another turn and a turnover committed by Montreal. Going Winnipeg's way, protecting a 10-point lead with just 8 seconds on the clock now until halftime. Dakota Prukop in and just carrying the football for a yard or so just to kill the clock here and head to the dressing room with a 10-point lead. Interesting first half of football here in Grey Cup 110.
Well, absolutely. The turnover in the kicking game that led to 7 points for the Bombers and just an enormous goal line stand by Mike O'Shea's defense. All about lowest leverage down there on the goal line, and the Bombers just turn Montreal away. Wow.
This will be it for the half. Prukop. Just to take a knee and head to the dressing room, leading it 17-7. Great start by Winnipeg's offense. Time of possession in that first quarter. They had it most of the way and scored in their first two drives. Give Montreal credit, though. They've shown offensively they are able to move the football.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, Cody Fajardo has found his number one target in Austin Mack a few times. We've seen a couple of catches by Tyler Snead. A nice run in that first score for the Owls from William Standback. So those who felt that, you know, this Montreal Alouette offense was an issue, they showed that they can be productive.
Let's go down to Claire Hanna now with Brady Oliveira.
Brady, we saw you with that first touchdown, and then you had a huge run to set up the second touchdown. What are you seeing, and what is the Montreal defense giving you?
Yeah, you know, we're prepared. You know, this offensive line, these receivers, this entire offensive unit, we're prepared. We had a great week of prep. We watched a ton of film. We know what they want to do. We know they want to create turnovers, right? It's going to be a game of ups and downs, but we got each other's backs out here.
And then we saw your defense with that goal line stand. How much confidence does that give your team going into halftime?
Huge. Our defense has a bunch of dogs on there, so we weren't surprised, but it definitely gives a lot of good added motivation, and I know that our defense has their back when they're out there.
Thank you very much, Brady. Okay, let's go over to you, Matthew.
William, I understand that a turnover on downs close to the goal line can be demoralizing, but we saw the way you attacked their defensive line. How much is that going to be the purpose going into the second half?
It's going to be very important. We just got to make sure we establish a run game so we can get the receivers the ball. First quarter was decent, but we got to come with more firepower.
And your 40-yard touchdown run for you after everything you've been through, how energizing is that in this game for you?
It's good. It got me pumped up and lets everybody know that, yo, we can keep it going. We just got to trust it. We got to believe in it. And like I said all the time, we got to execute every play that is called.
30 more minutes. We'll see you soon.
Let's go.
Halftime and break up 110 in Hamilton. Oh, a goal line stand by Winnipeg has kept it a 10-point game, 17-7. Those what-if moments, Glenn, that the panel talked about, Montreal just has to put them aside and know they can move the football.
Well, love the debate from the panel. Loved Green Day, and we got a second half to go here. But yeah, I think, you know, the one thing that jumps out for me is, A, they are going to keep pounding Brady Oliveira for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, and Jason Moss's group defensively has got to be strong in the run defense. But Montreal offensively can move the football through the air. Cody Fajardo was 10 of 12 for 123 and hit some balls down the field.
He did. Big one to Austin Mack, 31 yards, and had the big run from William Standback for the touchdown. They scored quickly at the end of the first quarter and could have had that touchdown to make it a three-point game, but no. Strong work by the Winnipeg defense. It's a 10-point hole for the Alouettes, who will receive the ball. They had deferred, and they will get it here to start the second half. The first ever Grey Cup. It's over 100 years of this. First time ever, a team from Montreal playing a team from Winnipeg. And it's been entertaining so far. Turnovers have been huge. And working against the Alouettes as Sergio Castillo begins the second half of the 2023 Grey Cup. Went 50, and so a good place to start for Cody Fajardo. A look at what he did in the first 30 minutes.
Yeah, he got early on some chemistry going with his number one receiver in Austin Mack. Got Tyson Philpott on a couple of those bubble screens, which they've done a lot of this year. And a nice run by William Standback. I liked in the second quarter how Jason Moss moved the pocket, got Cody Fajardo outside, got him on the run a little bit. Puts a bind on the defense when your quarterback has the option to run or throw it. Early points in this first drive of the second half would be important after that goal line stand by Winnipeg to end the first half.
And there is an injured player down for the Blue Bombers on that kick coverage, and it happens to be their starting field corner, Jamal Parker.
That's a matchup Matt Dunnigan just talked about at halftime. See if they could get Austin Mack in a one-on-one with Jamal Parker outside. We'll see. This is Fletcher on the return. There's Parker. He makes that first contact and took the worst of that tackle.
Well, he's out for at least a few plays. Nick Hallett is in that Bomber secondary now. First and 10 at the Montreal 50. Opening possession of this second half for the Alouettes. Moved the ball well right at the end of the half. Just couldn't cash in. William Standback, left side. And he puts his head down on a big collision there with Dietrich Nichols to get it up around midfield.
I see you, 3-1. I see you. You got to love that. That's some physical play and a good hit from the other side. And Dietrich Nichols and big William Standback. I like to call him the hammer. William the Standback hammer. And he steps up, man. Good contact downfield.
A gain of four, just shy of midfield for Fajardo. Changing the play on a second and six. Pressure is coming.
It's a blitz, so outside is the one-on-one. No help for Demario Houston. He's just got to try and run with Mack. Now the ball's deliberately underthrown from Cody Fajardo. He wants to throw back shoulder so that Mack can put the brakes on and come back at it. He only has one hand, and he pulls it down. Wow.
What an incredible catch by Austin Mack. Down inside the 25.
Fajardo sees the matchup again, throws it to the back shoulder, and Cole Speaker's got a great cut touchdown.
A 23-yard pass, Cody Fajardo. The Cole Speaker. And they're an extra point away, making it just a field goal difference. Cote converts Fajardo to the end zone, and a Grey Cup touchdown for second-year receiver Cole Speaker, 17-14.
Defense, that's Adam Big Hill and Evan Holm. They're going to switch on these routes, a go route and a push to the flat. You see the switch? Stop it here. Holm now takes the flat route, and now that leaves the middle linebacker, Adam Big Hill, on a slot back in Cole Speaker. Cole Speaker gets in behind him, and again, keep in mind, Adam Big Hill's gutting it through a bad calf, and he just can't catch up to the slot back. Throw behind, touchdown Montreal.
Which has just changed the complexion of this Grey Cup for how quickly that Alouette offense is working. Two touchdown drives, Glenn. One took four plays, that one took only three. And a couple of big passing plays. Speaker with the touchdown with Big Hill in the coverage. And also that one by Austin Mack. We'll be playing that one back for years to come. A one-hander for 33 yards. Johnny Augustine back for this return as well. But how about Austin Mack and that catch?
Well, I'll tell you what, we have this feature all year in the regular season. It's called One More Time. We see a big play like this, we go, let's go one more time and take a look at it. How about this? Getting pulled down by Houston and just with one hand rips it in and pulls it down with him. Mack with a huge catch to set up a very important major for the Montreal Alouettes.
His left hand was tied up. He couldn't use it, and he didn't need it.
Didn't need it.
One more time. The Alouettes want to be looking his way at least one more time in this game. They're down three, but they have momentum. And it's on the sweep. And Nick Dembski, he finds an opening. And around the edge on the right side before he's pushed out of bounds. And a first down for the Bombers.
The only guy that can really make a difference in this play is Sean Lemon. He's going to get blocked. Dembski comes from the right of your screen, around to the left on the fly sweep, and you see he gets picked up. Nice block by the receiver downfield, and an inside cut for Dembski. First down, Bombers.
That's down to the Montreal 48. A gain of 17 yards for Nick Dembski. Like Brady Oliveira, product of Oak Park High School in Winnipeg. Back to the ground. Speaking of Oliveira, had an excellent first half with 69 on the ground and gets well over 70 yards there on the game as he gets it down to a second and short. It'll be about 3 yards shy.
Whenever the Bombers have a good first down play that turns into an automatic, like over 10 yards, they go right to Oliveira. This is Buck Pierce, one of the top offensive coordinators in the Canadian Football League. Look at that points per game average at 33 points. That's why they won the West. They've got a dynamic offense, can win in a lot of ways, but every time they have a big play, They go right to Oliveira, the first down.
Trying to defuse that momentum that Montreal got with that touchdown. And they're down at the 41 and a second down and three. Back to Oliveira. He breaks a tackle and gets a first down. Winnipeg on the move.
So much pre-snap motion in Buck Pierce's offense. That's Janarian Grant going from left to right in your screen, and Grant is just enough to freeze Darnell Sankey in the middle, and then Dembski can get his blocking angle on the middle linebacker. With that pre-snap motion, it freezes the defense for just a second, and Sankey can't get there.
Here's Bomber offense moving right back inside the Montreal 35 now in a first down. Faking Oliveira and throwing it. It is caught by Kenny Lawler near another first down. He has it just inside the Alouette 25. A gain of 9. Another second and short coming up.
Zach Kolaris just doesn't get enough credit for his negotiation of the pocket, for the way he moves around. He can throw in bad angles. It doesn't have to be textbook for this veteran star quarterback to complete a big pass over the middle. Can throw from a lot of different throwing angles.
So that goes spotted right at the 25. Dakota Prukop, who scored a short yardage touchdown early in this Grey Cup, will come on again now to pick up the first down. And he does. And then some. Rolls down around the 20.
How about the left side of that Barmer O-line? Prukop in these short yardages isn't getting the one he needs. These guys over here just pushing that line of scrimmage and resetting it about 4 yards down the line. It's a battle in the trenches. We'll give that one to the Bombers. It's a big veteran group up front.
It sure is. Yep. It's Stanley Bryant there, but a lot of those guys, they've been together for a while.
And played together all season. Just Stanley Bryant missing one game, but that was only because they'd already locked it up.
Let it roll, let it roll. Go.
Fourth trip to the red zone in this Grey Cup game. The first down from the 19. Oliveira. Pinned down. And just a couple that time. He has had a very good game, had that great start. Carried it 8 times, also caught a pass in the opening drive against BC last week and scored the touchdown. What a statement that was for Winnipeg, doing it on the ground. They've had success running the football in this game.
Big call here for Noel Thorpe, the defensive coordinator, on second down. Possibly hold the Bombers to a field goal attempt here. Does he go with straight pressure, leave his DBs in one-on-one? Was that he's not telling anybody right now? Was that the signal?
What is it?
Must have heard you speculating here. Second and 9 from the 18. With time, complete down around the 10. And a first down. Looks like it'll be a first down and goal coming up here with Drew Wolitarski getting the catch.
Drew Wolitarski's the 3 receiver. Usually he's the wide out, but this time they put Dembski outside wide, and it's just that deep crossing route. Just 3-man pressure from the Montreal Alouettes. So Thorpe on that play decides to go coverage. Drop 9 back in the defensive secondary. Zach Kolaris hits that short crosser for the first down.
But as far as you can go in a first and goal, it is just inside the 10. Winnipeg is threatening again, and already an excellent answer after the Alouettes stole the momentum back with that quick three-play drive for the touchdown by Cole Speaker.
Go! What is that?
Takes the handoff, Kolaris into the end zone, intercepted! Kavion Ento, intended for Kenny Lawler. And Ento reached back and hauled it down for another big defensive play, this time by Montreal. Just as the Bombers were down and threatening, Ento to the rescue again. Still a 3-point Winnipeg lead.
What an outstanding pick by Ento. There he is there. His man is actually Rasheed Bailey. And the corner route's coming from the inside on Kenny Lawler. Watch how Ento is going to keep his eyes on the routes. He's looking here, and he's looking at the quarterback and Zach Collars. Where does he want to throw it? I'll drop my guy, cut underneath the corner route, and make just a spectacular athletic play to climb the ladder and rip it down in front of Lawler.
He had a big knockdown in the first half.
Did it again. That Montreal defense has been outstanding through the playoffs. 8 turnovers in the Eastern Final. They needed a big one down there with Winnipeg on the doorstep. But they've been the best in the CFL this year in scoring from their defense with 9 defensive touchdowns, a couple more in the playoffs.
Caleb Evans is in now. They need less than a yard for a first down. Just across the 39.
Get out! 19!
Stands under center, and this time goes a little differently than it did the last time. He tried that on a third and goal when he couldn't punch it into the end zone. They do get that first down, and back comes Fajardo.
For the record, on the discussion and controversy on the goal line stand before the half, for the record, I liked the call to go for it on third down. I just wouldn't have emptied the backfield. I would have left William Standback back there and maybe given it to him,
so,
or even have him as a threat to delay the defense from submarining. Just for the record.
So you're with Bo.
I'm with Bo.
Not with the coaches Barker and Lapolis there. We'll call it 2-2 on that decision then. First and 10. Alouette 42, William Standback. He's had a good day. He's had a great cup touchdown on the ground. Scan the QR promo code on screen to get 40% Crave annual plans and start streaming the biggest hit shows everyone is talking about on Crave.
You saw that last play. William Standback picks up 5 off tackle. Leave the regular offense out there. Run Standback. I like your chances.
He's got 7 carries for 50 yards. Long as 32 for a touchdown in his first Grey Cup. Second four, knocked down. Coming in hard is Brian Cole, who got right in the face of Cody Fajardo. Third down coming up.
Winnipeg Blue Bombers in the West Final. Zach Vernon Adams Jr. 9 times. I mean, they got to him. And it was by committee, not just the regular names. And Brian Cole was one of them. He got one. Malik Clements got a pair. They're rotating the linebackers.
So Janarian Grant goes back for the punt. Remember, he had a punt return touchdown. That was early fourth quarter a year ago at Mosaic in Regina against the Argos. The punt by Joseph Seymour. Take it. No, it bounces in behind him. Takes a roll. It's not going into the end zone as he thought it would, so he has to pick it up at the 1. And he's taken down well shy of the 10. Gets a few yards, but a punt of 61 yards for Joseph Zima. Timely, too, because it's pinned the Bombers with the ball, but deep. Chill, protect that football. Dakota Brukop. Just beforehand, they're working on that, making sure he just hangs on to it in case this happens.
Yeah,
he's been called into that situation before. He catches it with one of Winnipeg's touchdowns. Our Coors Light moment of chill.
Hit pretty hard there too by Darnell Sankey, and during Green Day there were a few Coors Lights being consumed in here.
You want to protect those too.
No, right in.
Zach Valero's Winnipeg ball inside the 10 to stop. 17-14 game. Lawal Ugawag and Darnell Sankey on Brady Oliveira there after he gets it. Well, a gain of about 4 or 5.
Even when you play Brady Oliveira heads up and you've played it correctly, he still gets 4. Sankey played that as well as a middle linebacker can, and Oliveira got 4.
Capacity crowd here at Tim Hortons Field. fans on both sides and making lots of noise now on a second and six in the Winnipeg 13. Kolaris, he's got time. Out of the pocket and off to the left, complete to Dembski. Across the 20, across the 25, taken down, and a big first down for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
Well, this is big for a lot of reasons. One, the protection is good, and again, Zach Kolaris, his ability to negotiate, be patient, not get flustered by and feel like there's ghosts coming. But Dembski's going to be dying on the sideline over there. He's dropped because of the movement from Kolaris. There's two-way go there for Tyrese Beverett. He has one guy inside and one guy on the boundary. He's wrong either way.
In a 15 yards, Kolaris 12 of 16 for 162 through that one pick last time out to Kavion Enta. Handing off. The Bomber backfield.
Yeah, it looked like Tyrese Beverett was on the ground signaling like
holding Winnipeg number 51. 10-yard penalty. Remains first down.
So they call the right tackle Jamarcus Hardrick, who is the Western nominee for most outstanding lineman. He's had a great year. That pushes Winnipeg back.
Yeah, it looked like he made a tackle right at the point of attack.
So they're back to their 18 now on a first and 20. From an empty backfield. Pressure coming. Gets it away. Open and caught. And a big play there for the Bombers, and Dembski again as he eats up a lot of yardage on that first and 20. It'll be a second and short coming up.
Lawal Ugawak is coming in on a stunt, and standing in there is Kolaris. He's got to have to throw, and I talked about arm angles early in the first half and how good he is at throwing around the rush. He had Ugawak right in his face, right up in his kitchen. He throws it around it to complete that first down, and the Bombers are getting out of the shadow of their own goalposts.
One quick play here to pick up. It's over 18. It's a second and short again. And Kolaris to the sideline for Prukop. It's a second down. Another quick quarter here. We're down to barely 2 minutes left in this third quarter and a three-point game. Prukop, right side, first down.
Well, two great Canadian star offensive players for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. 1,500 yards rushing for Brady Oliveira. Over 1,000 yards receiving for Dembski. We've seen a big catch here on this drive by number 10. Both coming from Oak Bay High School. Both coached by Stu Nixon at Oak Bay. And by the way, one other star CFL football player that went to that high school in Winnipeg, Andrew Harris. One of the mentors for both these guys, but certainly Brady Oliveira.
Outstanding names from one high school program in Winnipeg. And flags coming out here as well, but Brady Oliveira has talked about
procedure.
That.
Winnipeg number 66. It's a five-yard penalty. Remains first down.
I just think about a high school football coach that's made such a difference, and they certainly do across this country. But to have three guys, he must be in hot. Apparently he just retired recently, about a year ago, but coaching all three of those guys that have just become stars at the pro level.
Well, the last time they were here in Hamilton, all three were on this Winnipeg team, Andrew Harris as well, celebrating a Grey Cup victory over the Ticats in overtime. Fourth straight appearance for the Bombers. The Edmonton kid who went to college at TCU in his final year comes up and fires big time there on Oliveira.
He's coming on a stunt from inside out, and he just lowers his pad level and explodes into Oliveira.
Ugawak, since becoming a starter, he's been great for that Montreal D, so something along the screen at Dembski. Another big hit coming in, it's Sankey. And this Alouette defense is fired up.
It's on now. It's on. close to this fourth quarter. Both these teams can feel it. That's Darnell Sankey flying around and making a hit on the little screen going out to the left side by Nick Dembski. Watch out, one's coming. There he is.
Double whammy, Sankey.
Yeah, Avery Williams in there, too.
The two of them on Dembski. So a third and long now. Tyson Philpott is back, not James Letcher, for this punt by Jamison Sheen. So a good stand there by the defense and trying to angle it off to the right. A shorter punt, end over end. Philpott takes it, gets it up across the 35 for Montreal. Whistle went.
Saying he's down. Just see if... Harry Ainsley High School in Edmonton.
Lowell Ugowak. Sort of a hard-hitting D for Montreal. They've got the ball back. Heading to the fourth quarter. We got a game and break up 110. 3-point Winnipeg lead. And nothing, making statements on both sides of the ball.
One possession game, numbers are pretty close, guys are turning it up a notch when it comes to the physicality. We got a game going into the fourth.
As said, in both sides too, not just that quick touchdown drive, but that interception at such a critical time in the end zone by Into.
Yeah, just a great three quarters of football, and we're coming back with a fourth quarter and a big finish.
Big fourth quarter in store on this one. And you know, tonight the CFL and TSN crew would like to wish Matty Pouliot all the best in her retirement. Matty has been the main travel coordinator for the CFL and TSN crew for 10 years. Been a part of the TSN family since 2011. Tireless workers, always been available to deal with our travel issues, and that means 24/7. Matty, we wish you all the best. It'll be tough to replace Madeline Pouliot. Fourth quarter begins. First and 10, Montreal 36. That is caught by Aspen Mack. He's had a great game as he picks up a gain there that gets across the 40.
Well, from our MVP at TSN, Matty, to a potential MVP of the Grey Cup Championship, Austin Mack, another big catch over the middle.
He has five catches for 90 yards, and yeah, the one they're going to be talking about, a 33-yarder, one-handed for Austin Mack, second and four, Alouette 42, down by three, fourth quarter in Hamilton. Deep look, Fajardo, and the coverage is great, and it's intercepted. Beautiful pick by Evan Holm, double coverage on Mack that time, and the Alouettes turn the ball over.
Cody Fajardo had what he wanted because he saw a safety, Brandon Alexander, a little bit shallow, but Holm makes the play.
Evan Holm, Winnipeg's leader in total defensive plays, has a big one there. Bomber ball. In the context of that, I would say Lowell Ugowak was first.
Stepping in there on Brady Oliveira, who's having a pretty good night. And what a hit.
They followed that up with another big one by Darnell Sankey, but Ugowak, one of their top draft picks in 2023. Four tackles for him for the Alouette rookie. It's Winnipeg football after another turnover, the interception by Evan Holm. And they'll start at their 21, still protecting a three-point lead. Down to 14 minutes left in the fourth quarter. And working his way through a hole on the left side is Brady Oliveira, taking down by Mustafa Johnson.
Let's take a look at that pick again. There's Austin Mack, the number two receiver. He's going to take advantage. I think this was the right throw from Cody Fajardo. Stop it there. Brandon Alexander is just a little bit shallow. That's why he thinks he's got the post over the top, but Evan Holm closes quickly and makes the big play. We'll see if Zach Kolaris can convert here on second and medium. But what a catch by Holm on the interception with no safety help.
After that five-yard carry by Brady Oliveira, he's closing in on 100. He's got 96 for this great catch. Taken down, coming in Reggie Stubblefield, their strong side linebacker, has the sack on Zach Kolaris.
Coming right off the edge with Sean Lemon, right off off the edge with Sean Lemon, and they're going to work together. There he is there, and Lemon is going to just occupy Jamarcus Hardrick's attention long enough, and then the inside move by Stubblefield, that gets Hardrick in a bind, and he gets home.
Another big defensive stand by the Alouettes on a third down and long from the Winnipeg 18, Jamison Sheehan. And that one was taken by Tyson Philpott. Big return, Philpott. We saw that from him in his rookie year as well last year, in for James Letcher. And by the way, tonight we would also like to acknowledge longtime TSN employee Sabina Davis, who's working in master control for tonight's Grey Cup broadcast. Sabina has been at TSN for 36 years and has coordinated some of the biggest events in the network's history, not only the Grey Cups, but World Juniors, Olympics. Great employee, even better person. You will be missed, Sabina. All the best. Alouette football. And on that return by Philpott, they have it inside the Winnipeg 30. They're in field goal range. They trail by a field goal. Handing off Liam Stainback. And he has that inside the 25, closer to the 20-yard line after a pickup of six more yards for him.
Sometimes you don't need to make contact to make a block. And James Tuck, the fullback, is going to make contact, or not make contact, but do enough to help Stainback on this cutback. Number 40 got in the way there. Nice cut inside from Stainback. And what Tuck did was kept Jackson Jeffcoat wide. Couldn't get involved in the tackle.
It's down to the 22. The Alouettes suddenly pressing. Second and four. Cody Fajardo. Good protection. It's complete. Down around the 12. Tyler Snead. First down, Alouettes.
Well, one thing that can't be understated here for Montreal and their offense is the protection that Cody Fajardo is getting up front. I mean, we've talked all year about how good the Bomber offensive line is, but Fajardo's been able to stand in that pocket and deliver. He's got a clean pocket here to get it outside and throw that out on time with accuracy. And remember, the bookends are on the other side. Jackson Jeffcoat and Willie Jefferson. That old line's holding up nicely.
At the Winnipeg 13, a first and 10 Alouettes. First time in this Grey Cup, the Montreal Alouettes have the lead.
Mixing it up, not giving them a steady diet of any one look. This is the bubble screen this time, a play that often goes to Tyson Philpott. Not this time. Austin Mack takes it home.
What a Grey Cup debut for Austin Mack. Has the touchdown. Fajardo, 16 of 20. Two TD passes thrown. A 13-yard strike to Mack. To make it a four-point game in favor of the Alouettes. Cote puts it through. They were down 10 before the half and missed a big chance to get closer. They've been taking advantage of their chances since. Austin Mack, Grey Cup touchdown.
Austin Mack needs one block to make this work. James Tuck, the fullback, in back-to-back plays now, is the guy that's going to deliver that block. He needs one block, and it's on the halfback, Diedrich Nichols. Right there is the block that eliminates Nichols, takes him out of his angle so that Mack can get inside of Houston and get to the end zone. Well-executed bubble screen on the outside to Austin Mack.
How good does that feel for Cody Fajardo? He's thrown a couple of touchdowns in the Grey Cup. And Austin Mack with six catches, 103 yards, and that TD up by four. Bombers to get the ball back. Jadarian Grant at the 15. He's trying to get that edge around the left side. Wesley Sutton chasing him, but a great return by Jadarian Grant. The all-time returns leader in Grey Cup history has put the Bombers in good shape to start near midfield after a 44-yard return.
Boy, did he have a game last year. Over 200 yards, almost 300 return yards in the championship game versus the Argos. But again, these great returners, after a score, sometimes they don't need to put it in the end zone to really make a positive impact. That helps Zach Collares in a big way to be right at center field.
Zach Collares is 14 to 18 for 185. He's thrown that one touchdown in the Alouette end zone by Enta. First and 10 near midfield, rolling to the right. He throws it off and he completes it too. He set up a second and long. Rashid Bailey with the catch. Another one of those Bombers playing in the Grey Cup for the fourth straight time. Bailey with his first reception of this Grey Cup.
Yeah, and you can see that Zach Collares, as a veteran quarterback, understands that all eyes are on him. They've just given up the lead for the first time tonight. And now he knows his teammates are looking at him to keep it calm. Just get that offense moving again. Get a couple of first downs and into field goal range. That's goal number one. Then they want to try to punch it in. It's goal number two.
Short yardage. Dakota Prukop in again on a second down and two. And an Alouette defender. That was Sankey flying over the top. And Prukop does indeed get that Winnipeg first down.
Tell you what, Stanley Bryant, Jeff Gray, Chris Kolinkowski off that left side. And I believe they're bringing in Eli as well to be the basic sixth offensive lineman, tight end. And their fullback getting involved in Damian Jackson. But that left side is pushing the pile. Keep that in mind if they need a short yardage play to try and win this game.
They are down to the Montreal 43. They are now trailing by 4 points, under 10 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. Here in Grey Cup 110. On the ground, Oliveira. He continues to rack up the yardage as he gets over 100 with that carry.
Boy, the key is always trying to get a block on the middle linebacker, and this time it's Kenny Lawler. Kenny Lawler, and Brady Oliveira will tell you that Kenny Lawler is a guy, one of the receivers of the entire group that's going to go up, and he's to the left of your screen right there, and he's going to get up on Darnell Sankey, up on those linebackers, get that big block in the second level to get Brady Oliveira. Oliveira told us, hey, our receivers will go block. They love it.
Short yardage again. Prukop rotating right back in on those good gains on first down. So on a second and short, he gets the first down again. They move the sticks, driving inside the 35, at the very least in field goal range. Two great running backs in this Grey Cup game. Oliveira and stand back in. A look at how they stack up so far.
Well, Oliveira in two games against Montreal was over 100 yards in both of them in the regular season. Had 100 yards in the first half in the West Final. He's over 100 again. Will it be enough, though, tonight?
Let it roll, let it roll,
let
it roll,
entire CFL in rushing yards.
What is?
Over 1,500. First and 10 from the 32. Back they go to number 20, who puts his head down on Darnell Sankey. Middle linebacker for the Alouettes. Those two collide, but call it three or four more for Brady Oliveira.
Throughout the playoffs, throughout the regular season, this is when the Montreal defense makes a play. They're backing up into their own end. Second and medium. That favors the offense. This is where they've been able to step up and make plays. We've seen Ento do it down in the end zone.
Call it a gain of 5, second and 5. Winnipeg 15 to 21 in second down conversions from the 27. Some pressure coming. It's dumped off there to Nick Dempsey. He gets it down closer to the 20. Very close to another first down.
Excellent pickup by Brady Oliveira on the block here. Oliveira is going to see the pressure coming from the left side of his offensive formation. And I know it's a screen pass over there to Dembski, but if he doesn't make that block, I think he gets home.
What a game. 4 point difference. And the clock just ticking down rapidly. Under 7 minutes now in the fourth quarter. First and 10. Bombers want their lead back.
What is?
From the Alouette 22. Faking to Oliveira. caught inside the 15 and a flag has come out. Rashid Bailey with another catch in this great cup.
In front of Wesley Sutton on the curl. See what the flag is. It was right around where the ball was caught, and it was after, sort of after the fact.
Jason Moss in his first Grey Cup as a head coach. He's won as a player. He's won as an assistant. The Argos back
legal
in
contact.
2012.
Montreal number 24. 10-yard penalty. It makes it a first down.
The legal contact called against Marc-Antoine Ducroix. A first down now around the 12 for Winnipeg.
Ducroix right there in the middle of your screen. He goes flying up to go get Wolitarski on the push route. There's no question there's contact there. First down, Winnipeg.
Noel Thorpe thinks there is a question about it.
What is it?
From the 11, first down. He's playing the drive. Oliveira driving to the 5 and inside it before he's taken down by Stubblefield.
Talked about Oak Park and Andrew Harris's influence on Brady Oliveira. Andrew always has told us throughout his career that as a tailback, it's important to just press the line of scrimmage with the ball. Press it when you get the ball in the hands. It's not like you're running straight through a hole. Press the line until you see that hole develop, and that's what Brady Oliveira does there. Waits, is patient, pressing the line, and then sneaks in to get inside the 5.
After giving up the lead, the Bombers have marched impressively right back down the field. Another great drive produced by Winnipeg that's taken almost 5 minutes off the clock. Second and 2 with the Alouette 4. Prukop is in again. Right side! Touchdown! His second touchdown of this game to go along with the 2 he scored in short yardage last year. And this time, Dakota Prukop wasn't looking for just a yard.
Well, and I think this time Montreal says, well, we'll load a couple extra guys on that left side because that's the way he's been going every single short yardage play. So Prukop just says, okay, you're going to put an extra one over there. I'll take it to the right side. I like that side, too.
You've seen Brady Oliveira, the runner, too, and you see that block on the right on Kavion Ento to help spring him in on that right side. 9 plays.
Big drive.
56 yards and 5.5 minutes taken off the clock. Winnipeg leads again. Castillo the point after. It's back to a field goal difference. My goodness, what a finish in store. Final 5 as Prukop celebrates in style.
This Bomber team is battle-tested, comes to the postseason, and losing the lead or going behind in this game doesn't faze them. They go to the Brady drive. Brady run, Brady run, Brady block. When Dembski gets the screen, Brady run to get him down to the goal line. And then Prukop, short yardage, 9 plays, 56 yards. Monster drive for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers to take the lead.
Just after Montreal had taken it for the first time, the ensuing drive, back comes Winnipeg, leading by 3. And James Letcher's not in the return game. Tyler Steed is back there with Tyson Philpott. Philpott comes in to take it around the 25, and he is upended by Nick Hallett up around the 35. So back comes Austin Mack, who's had a great game. In fact, we look at our Tim Horton's loads of taste. We got to go back to that catch again.
We'll watch this all night long. That's a biggie. Does he have another one in him before this one's over?
Why use two hands when one will do for Austin Mack? 6 catches, 103 yards. That was his longest one. He did have a 31-yarder as well. And he has 1 touchdown in this great cup from the 35. Has 10, has about 12, 13 more yards as he is slow to get up. And favoring his left arm as William Standback is now heading off.
Well, look like like Jackson Jeffcoat at the end of this run is he's kind of already in the air and dies and lands on Stanback, and I think that's where he got hurt. It almost looked like right there that almost incidental contact.
And so Jeshrin Antwi is in at running back. And he has the ball, takes that pass, tries to turn it up. Shane Gauthier comes in to take him down right around the 50 and a pickup of about 3 yards.
Antwi, product of the University of Calgary. So many Dinos playing in the Canadian Football League and had a big, important touchdown to seal the deal in the Eastern Final.
And he's done well supplementing the Alouette running game for William Stanback. Had a lot of carries last year when Stanback missed much of the season. Saying no catch. They're saying no catch. So a good break for the Alouettes.
Reda Cramby was there so quickly. University of Montreal Caravan product. We'll show you in regular speed first. See what the officials saw. There's 17 top of your picture. Was that a catch and a fumble? Incomplete. He said it was incomplete.
No catch.
By the way, congratulations to the University of Montreal and UBC. They'll be playing in the venue next week.
The punt by Zima. For the second time in this Grey Cup, he has put it out of bounds, trying to keep it away from Janarian Grant. Understandably, but it cannot go out of bounds in the air outside the 15.
Number 36, 10-yard penalty. First down, Winnipeg.
Cannot go out of bounds outside the 15 in the air. So, yeah, that's happened twice, and a better place to start for Winnipeg.
Well, he's had an issue with a couple of kicks here tonight, but he did have the one great one that had the backspin that got inside the 5. Joseph Zima has had a couple just go off the side, almost like he's trying to keep it away from Janarian Grant so much that he just dove hooked that one straight out of bounds.
And that's just a net of 13 yards. And as said, Joseph Zima was the top punter in the CFL in terms of net yardage.
Well, I thought he had a great Eastern Final. He kept it away from Javon Leak, special teams player of the year in the CFL, very well in the Eastern Final, but a couple of shanks tonight gives Zach Kolaris great field position.
We are getting down to the final minutes, fourth quarter. Last play before the 3-minute warning. Some tough sledding inside as he picks up a couple. 2:48 on the clock. What finish is in store in this Grey Cup? 3-point lead, Winnipeg with the ball. And Winnipeg with a 3-point lead. Let's go down to Claire Hanna.
Well, Rod, it was a little bit quiet on this Bombers sideline, but that last turnover created a lot of energy. And as one of the players told me, a lot can happen in 3 minutes. They need to stay together, keep believing, and finish strong. Matthew, what's happening on the Alouette sideline?
Complete opposite, Claire, where there was once a lot of energy here, a lot of nervousness. And, Rod, you're looking at 2nd and 8 right now. It is really tense here. And Tyler Snead came off and apologized to Cody Fajardo after that drop pass. Cody Fajardo said, we'll get him back, but we're going to see now, Rod. Critical second down.
Critical for that Alouette defense. Under 3 minutes. Winnipeg trying to drive a little bit closer to at least get in field goal range. They want to work that clock down, too. A 3-point lead, 2:33 and counting. 2nd down and 8. Winnipeg at their 49. Pressure coming. Kolaris can't get away. They've got him. They get the sack. Ugowak is in there. Sankey as well. Their 4th sack of this game. And more importantly for them right now, some lost yardage, Winnipeg, and they have to punt the football away.
Darnell Sankey is just going to hug the line of scrimmage here to the right of your screen. He gets locked up, but he just doesn't want to give up an escape lane. He's going one-on-one with left guard Jeff Gray. Holds his ground. Kolaris can't find a receiver downfield. Big stop for the Owls.
Tyson Philpott is back. Jamis Machine punted away, standing just inside the Winnipeg 30. What kind of finish could be in store? Punt of 48, Philpott. 25, and not much more. A couple of more yards before he's taken down. So here it is.
Oh, boy. This is...
That marvelous trophy with such a history, first presented, or a form of it, in 1909. And what great moments we have seen in Grey Cup games. And that's a big moment, too. Something that you've experienced before, my friend, back in 1989, getting to hoist that.
Yeah, you almost get emotional watching that great piece of Canadian history make its way down to field level.
Soon to be presented, but to who? First and 10, Alouettes down three from the 27. To Philpott across the 30, the 35, and he gets it down near the 40, and a first down for Montreal.
Last time the Bombers were here in the Grey Cup 2 years ago, it went to overtime. They won it with some big plays on defense, not only at the end of the regular season, but in overtime, big interception won the game for the Bombers. Their defense is out there now again. Can they get the stop?
The last Grey Cup here 2 years ago went to overtime between Winnipeg and Hamilton. Might we be seeing that again? 1.5 minutes, 3-point difference. Quickly out to the right for Philpott. On that screen, he gets taken down by Gauthier, but he does get it up. Close to the 50, it'll be a second and short coming up after a gain of 8.
I'll tell you what, that's a big hit. And you can see that Tyson Philpott is trying to recover from that. There's Philpott, top receiver in the quads. There are four receivers to the field. And watch this hit coming inside out. Woo! They can feel it. They know how close they are to becoming a champion, both these teams.
Right now, thinking about being close to a first down, it is second down and short. Caleb Evans on. They need a couple of yards. Evans, right side and more. Like Brukoff, got more than he needed as he gets that one up at midfield. And the drive continues for Montreal.
Tough situation here for Jason Moss and this offense. I mean, this is what they want. The ball in their hands with a chance to go down and win it. And time to think major, just run the offense. But they are 10 yards from field goal range and pushing this to overtime. Got to keep both of those things in mind.
Back in 2019, the Bombers' first of this four-year run. It was decisive, 33-12. All drama since then for Winnipeg. Happening again. Down goes Fajardo. Gauthier in. A flag is down. Jackson Jeffcoat in on that sack as well. And a big loss.
Great show blitz here with all these
timeout, Montreal.
All these defenders at the line of scrimmage. The challenge for you offensively for the line is they've got seven up on the line, but four are going to rush. They just don't know which four. That time it was Gauthier. He gets home.
It's all three down football now. Yes, it's second and long, but they essentially have two downs to get there with just a minute left. 1:02 on the clock. The Alouettes need at least a field goal to force overtime in this Grey Cup game. Second and 18. Don't need it all at once. Fajardo.
Got something.
He's going to take off. Cody Fajardo, he is taken down at the 50. So it'll leave a third and 5. A 13-yard pickup for Fajardo. And now the game is on the line on a third down. 13-yard pickup for Fajardo. And now the game is on the line on a third down. Oh, the game is on the line on a third down.
David Cote's longest on the season is 51 yards. A little bit out of his range right here. You got to go on third down at this point. Under a minute.
Here we go. This could be it. Third and five. A deep block. Down the left. It's caught by Cole Speaker. Big first down inside the 20. The drive continues, and they are at the very least in position to tie this game.
Fajardo puts this on the outside shoulder of Cole Speaker just enough to keep it away from Jamal Parker. Speaker's in behind coverage. It was just a matter of, with the pressure, could Fajardo get it to him? He gets it up outside and over the top, drops it in for a 31-yard gain.
Jesh Renantui is still in at running back for the Alouettes. They're inside the Winnipeg 20. Down by three. Seconds to go. What drama in Hamilton. Philpott, in his second year out of the University of Calgary, has just made the catch of his life.
What a route by Philpott. His dad, Corey, is a Grey Cup champion.
A critical point after two with so little time left because a field goal's no good to Winnipeg.
Makes it a four-point game with 13 seconds to go. Fajardo puts it on the money, but watch the route run by Tyson Philpott. The upside for the Philpott brothers is through the roof. They're just getting started in their journeys, in their careers. Dad's in attendance watching. Corey Philpott won the championship with the BC Lions back in 94. He's got to be proud right now of his son Tyson. Great route run, and the ball put right where it had to be by Cody Fajardo.
And the cup is coming on, and the Alouettes are 13 seconds away from officially taking it. The knock on Montreal was this season, every team they beat had a record worse than them. Every team that they lost to had a record better than them. And then last week, the big upset on the 16-2 Toronto Argonauts. And then this, trailing by 10 at the half, 13 seconds to go, and the Bombers need a miracle now.
Now, if you're Montreal on the kickoff cover team, the question is, do they want to squib kick this and keep it out of the hands of Janarian Grant? Who we know the damage he can do in the return game. They certainly don't want to kick it directly to him and let a timing return get set up.
Well, if anyone can do it, number 80 for Winnipeg can. We have seen that time and again, including in a Grey Cup a year ago on a punt return over 100 yards for a touchdown. But David Cote, as you talked about, with the Alouettes coming over from Ottawa, has the takedown and just 8 seconds to go.
Now, Zach Collares is really efficient here. You know that the Montreal secondary is going to back way off. They can't give up. They can't let someone in behind them on a one-play deal. But if Collares can be real efficient, get it over here and out of bounds quickly with a couple seconds left so that he can throw the Hail Mary to the end zone, that's the Bombers' chance.
The goal.
What is it?
Collares again. It is caught. And they try to kick it into the end zone, and it doesn't make it there. The Montreal Alouettes had to beat the best regular season team in the East. They did. They had to beat the best in the West. They did. And now they are flying above the league for the first time in 13 years. The 2023 Grey Cup champions.
Fajardo. And was told all through the offseason that he was done, that it was over, that he couldn't get it done, that he couldn't win the big one.
Let's go down to Matthew Schenetti with the guy with the winning touchdown, Tyson Philpott.
Tyson, you saw the end zone in front of you. The play was called. Take us through the touchdown that just won the Grey Cup.
Hey, man, we talked about it all year. It was going to come down to one play. I saw one-on-one coverage. I knew Cody trusted in me. The rest is history.
You told me you and your brother had a heart-to-heart talk before the game. What did Jalen Philpott tell his brother?
He just told me how proud he was of me. He told me I'm going to be out there. I got to make a play. And I'm just glad I was able to see it to fruition. This is out of my dreams, man. I dreamed about this as a kid to get the game-winning touchdown, man. It's surreal.
And in front of your father, what does that mean to you? You are now the second Philpott to have your name on the Grey Cup, but to have your father here to watch that moment.
So much. I mean, and not even just my dad, man. My mom's here. My sister's here. They're the number one supporters all the time. I owe them for all of this. And mom, dad, sister, brother, I love you guys and can't wait to celebrate.
Tyson, congratulations.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Blair, that's Cody Fajardo.
Cody, congratulations. I know you won a Grey Cup in V17, but you're first as a starter. How does this feel right now?
It's like a movie. It's very emotional for me, and the guys on that sideline were the ones who believed in me, and Danny believing in me, Coach Moss believing in me. I knew when we took the field at the end, I grew up as a little kid wanting the ball in my hand with the game on the line. And I'm just thankful for that opportunity. God kept me healthy, and what a game. It was an incredible game.
When you talk about the island of misfit toys that this team is, the adversity you've overcome, the fact that you had to beat Toronto in the East Final and now Winnipeg, how did you guys get here?
Because everybody counted us out. You see these guys celebrating, that's what it's all about. This team was so close together. I've never been closer to a team ever. And we knew we had something special. And last week, we knew being a very tough Argos team, we had a chance. And that's a very good Winnipeg team. I am so proud. Three-phase effort. Guys showed up today, and I'm very proud of them.
I heard you had a dream about this moment.
Three dreams about winning a Grey Cup this year. Never once in my career have I done that. Here it is. It seems just like a dream. It's truly incredible.
And Cody, when you think about your journey here, being let go by Saskatchewan, you and your coach, just what kind of a comeback story is this for you?
It's a true underdog story, and maybe one day I can write a book about it, because honestly, the offseason was incredibly difficult for me and my family. And like I said, this organization having the faith in me, this one I'm going to cherish it for a very, very long time.
Congratulations, Cody.
Thank you very much. It's time to celebrate.
Okay, Matthew, over to you with William Standback.
William, I've known you for a little bit now. Take us through what your tears mean in this moment.
It's hard for me to even explain it, man. This is an unbelievable feeling, a feeling that I haven't had in years, man. Just the hard work, just all the dedication we put in, just the doubts that we had. Nobody believed in us from the season to start. And look what we had now. We're at the top, man, the top of the league. Man, we're the most doubted team, man. I can't believe we did it. But I knew we could. We believed in it from the very jump. When Moz came and we first met him, when he introduced himself, and then the computers wasn't working. We always go through adversity in Montreal. Whether it was our elevator breaking, we got to take the stairs, we got to walk a mile to our practice. All of that shit goes into the work that we put in to get right here to this big stage.
How about your own work? William, you lost your parents not too long ago. You were on your own tough journey. Your family is here. It's full of love. What are your feelings about your family in this moment?
I just can't wait to celebrate with them. I know my parents is looking down at me like, my damn son did it, man. Excuse my language, but, oh, man. I'm just ready to celebrate with the team, my family, and just have a wonderful offseason, man.
What do you think about Cody Fajardo coming in here? This island of misfit toys idea that we heard all season. And yet Jason Moss talked about be great to get an eighth Grey Cup for this franchise. When did this team really start believing?
When Cody first came in, man, I believed in from the jump. A lot of people, all the naysayers, all the doubters, they were sitting there saying that he's washed up. You know, Saskatchewan chewed him up and spit him back out. But he came here with a determination to change everything around and lead us to the promised land. And that was the first thing he had a conversation with us, and that's what he talked about. Just the person that he is, the leadership that he brings to this organization, man, we couldn't ask for nothing better than that.
William, you're a Grey Cup champion. Congratulations.
Thank you, man. I really appreciate it. You know, I'm gonna take this one and run with it. Can't nobody tell me nothing now.
No doubt.
Yes, thank you.
Claire Hanna has Sean Lennon.
Sean, I see the tears streaming down your face. I saw how hard you hugged Cody after this game. Just what emotions are you feeling right now?
It's unbelievable, man. The adversity that we've been through as a team. It's just so many players over here just perfectly fitting for it. We believe when nobody else believes. I'm just so happy for this team, this city. It's unbelievable.
But the adversity even you faced at the beginning of the season, no team wanted you. And the fact that you ended up here, how could you describe your journey?
I just stayed ready. I can't control that, whether a team wants me or not. All I can do is control what I do as a player, what I do in the offseason. I train my family, my support system. I'm just so thankful. Just so thankful.
When you reflect on this game against the Bombers, there was a lot of times when you guys were down. How did you keep that belief, and was there a turning point?
We fight. This team, we fight. We compete every day in practice. We fight. We believe when nobody else believes, and that's the reason why we're the Grey Cup champs.
When you reflect on your career, where is this moment going to rank?
This is the greatest moment right now in my career, honestly, because there's so much adversity, so much in believing in yourself. So much of it is just fight. And that's just for anybody out there, man. Just keep believing. Just believe when nobody else believes. Just put the time in, put the work in. Just put that passion in. Oh! It's the greatest fucking moment ever.
Sean, thank you. Okay, let's head it back over to Matthew, who's with Marc-Antoine Ducroix.
Right now, he's just sharing a moment. Marc-Antoine, about 4 hours ago, you told me when I asked you, how are you feeling? You said, in a minute, I'm not going to remember because I'm going to be so locked in. Have you come back to Earth yet?
No. I can't believe it, Matt. I cannot believe it. Since I was a kid, I watched the Alouettes. I've dreamed of this, of winning here, man. I've dreamed of winning that Grey Cup since I was a child. And to do it with the Alouettes. I have no word for that, man.
You are now alongside Étienne Boulay, Mathieu Proulx, some great French-Canadians. Jason Moss talked about the French-Canadian identity of this team. You talked all week to me about it. What does it mean to you to win the way the culture was built this season?
I think everything comes full circle. How Coach Moss put the emphasis on the French-Canadians, on learning French, of embracing the French culture. And look at us now. We started, we're the last on the ranking. Nobody thought we'll make it. Nobody. And we went to get an owner that's from Quebec, a GM that's from Quebec, a team full of Quebecers, and we made it to the end. Nobody can say anything. We're the champion. It's incredible. I got nothing else to say.
Well, at what moment of this season, because everyone kept talking about coming into this playoff, but you hadn't beaten a team that was over 500. But what moment did you kind of feel the vibe that no one else saw, that no one else maybe believed in, and that in the East Final, or before that, it was Hamilton, that those three steps, beating a team that was going to host the Grey Cup, then beating a team that was 16-2, now beating a team that's been to four straight Grey Cups. When did this team start believing?
If you love an underdog story, that's a perfect one, isn't it? Dead last, then beating all the odds. I think at the end of the day, if there's a lesson in this, no matter what people say, what the media say, if you believe in yourself and you do anything in your power to achieve it, good things will come out of it. And look at us. We're champions. We're champions, baby! Let's go!
Félicitations. Go enjoy.
Merci.
To Claire Hanna with Austin Mack.
Austin, this entire time that I've been standing here with you and your daughter Leia, you have not been able to wipe the smile off of your face. Just what kind of joy are you feeling in this moment?
Oh, man, I'm in loss of words, man. This team, what we've been through, to be here right now and to be Grey Cup champs, what the city of Montreal has been through. They haven't had a championship since 2010. Christian Matter, oldest guy, that was his rookie year. I mean, I'm just so overwhelmed for all of our guys, so happy for them. Hey, man, go out.
Now, when I think about your journey, there was a moment when you considered hanging up the cleats, not playing. I know it was your wife, Joy, that convinced you to keep playing. How different could things be if that didn't happen?
I mean, we could all say what ifs, but at the end of the day, man, I believed in God's plan for me and for my family. We put blind faith coming up here to Canada and Montreal, and just to end this thing with a Grey Cup championship, I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing.
You had a touchdown in this game, some major catches in clutch moments. When you guys were down, how did you keep that composure but keep that belief?
I mean, we've always believed. We've always been a team that's had to fight back all year. And, you know, defense gave us 2 minutes, plenty of time to be able to at least get in the field goal range. Coach Speaker made a hell of a catch over here on the left side of the field. We knew that I was going to be in the slot. We knew the corner might try and jump on me. It was a perfect play, perfect scheme by Coach Moss and the team. Coley threw up a great ball. And then to end it up, Tyson Philpott, man, way to finish with a big catch in the end zone. Ah, man, this is awesome. I'm so happy for the boys. Super excited for Cody Fajardo. Big shout out to Cody Fajardo. You want to talk about my journey? Talk about his journey. I mean, that guy's been through everything. And to be somebody that was written off, a scapegoat, and now he's a Grey Cup champ. He led this team through the playoffs and won against the best team, Toronto and Winnipeg. Come on, man. Go Owls, baby.
Austin, thank you so much and congratulations.
Thank you.
Matthew, over to you with Darnell Sankey.
Well, Darnell, you and I have spoken a lot over the last few weeks about not just the attitude, but the execution of this defense. When did you start to feel in this game the tide was starting to turn and this team was primed for a championship?
Halftime. We went in there at halftime and we all stood together and we said, you know what? We are not going to lose this game. We are not going to lose this game. All of us came in there, huddled up. We said, you know what? It's do or die. It's us or them. And we came out here and we bring it to them. Exactly what we said we was going to do.
Last night, those who've won Grey Cups and or been participants in Grey Cups stood up and they spoke. I hear that Cody Fajardo's speech brought down the house. Can you tell us what he said?
Cody Fajardo, man, he don't say much all the time. But when he talked to us as a team, I've never seen him yell that much in my life. And you know what? That dude's been through so much adversity and drama from Sask and from just the fans all year I've been seeing. Man, you know what? He's a good man. He deserved this today. He deserved this, man.
This is actually your second championship, but what does it mean to win a Grey Cup? Knowing that you chose Montreal, knowing that Sean Lemon wanted you, knowing that everyone in this defense looked to you to be a leader in that linebacking core.
Man, I just want to say glory to God, man. First and foremost, man. Glory to God. If it weren't for him, I would be nothing, man. Truly, I would be nothing. He deserves all the praise. You know, just D-A-N-D. What I've been saying from the beginning, D-A-N-D, delays are not denials, you know. It's a testimony for anybody out there who ever been doubted, anyone out there who people didn't believe in them. Have faith in yourself. Trust yourself. Trust in God. Get a family that's close to you and stay faithful. Keep faithful, man. Everything's going to turn out okay. Keep faithful.
You've got a trophy waiting for you, Darnell. Congratulations.
Yes, thank you so much. Appreciate you. Hey, D-A-N-T. D-A-N-T.
Welcome to the 2023 Grey Cup Awards and Trophy Presentation. To present the awards for Most Outstanding Player and Most Outstanding Canadian, here's James Duffy.
Thank you, Dustin, and thank you, Hamilton. We know 2 years ago you didn't have the chance to give us the full Grey Cup experience. You did this year. It was a spectacular week. Commissioner Randy Ambrosi is standing by to present the Most Outstanding Player, the Most Outstanding Canadian, and the big prize in just a couple of minutes. The Most Outstanding Player of the 2023 Grey Cup game, Cody Fajardo. Cody and his son Luca, I know this past winter you're home with your newborn and your wife, and Saskatchewan doesn't want you back. You're thinking about retirement. Then Montreal calls. Could you have ever imagined you'd be up here as the MVP of the Grey Cup?
You know, it was my wife's decision for me to come and play football. She said, I'm not done yet, and I wouldn't be here without her. I wouldn't be here without Danny Mack and Coach Moss believing in me. This is very emotional for me. But this team, this organization believed that I could be a Grey Cup winning quarterback. And to be standing here in front of you guys and saying that we are Grey Cup champs, this team will go down as one of the best teams in CFL history.
Certainly, we've seen upsets in the Grey Cup before, but I don't think we've ever seen a team beat a 16-2 team and then beat a team that won two Grey Cups in 3 years back-to-back. What made you guys believe when not a lot of others did in you?
We said 1% from the get. When we went to the playoffs, we said 1% is believing in us, our fans and every guy in that locker room. And we wanted to go out there and prove them all right. Who cares about all the haters? We wanted to prove the people that backed us right, and we did that tonight. And I love this team so much.
Cody Fajardo, the most outstanding player. The most outstanding Canadian in the 2023 Grey Cup is Tyson Philpott. Your dad was a Grey Cup champion. I'm sure he told you stories. What does it mean to you to be up here?
It means so much. Being a Canadian, I dreamed about this since I was about 6 years old. I envisioned it, and just to get here on the biggest stage and to get it done, man, it feels so good.
It's one thing to win a Grey Cup. It's another thing to catch the winning touchdown in one of the most dramatic finishes ever. Tell me about the play.
Man, I seen the safety roll over. I knew I had a post route. Number seven, he trusted in me. All year we've been working. Everyone wrote us off, but we didn't worry about that. We finished this shit, and I'm so glad I can celebrate with my dogs.
Congratulations. And now, Commissioner Randy Ambrosi will present the Grey Cup to the Montreal Alouettes. Looking right now, we'll get him. Jason, congratulations. You told me earlier this week how you'd worked in this tenure with Montreal to control your emotions more. No need to control them now. What does this mean?
Yeah, it means everything. I mean, I'm so grateful for this group of guys to come together. We played for someone other than ourselves all year. We talked about it from day one, winning the Grade 8, the number 8 Grey Cup for this organization, how we want to represent Montreal and Quebec and the 425 that we talked so strongly about. But it took a great group of guys to work hard every day to do this. I couldn't be happier or prouder. And honestly, this is beyond my imagination of what it could be like or feel like. So I'm just thankful. The last thing is, you know, we talked about it this week. If we didn't finish this, only we would remember this team, and it was going to be a measuring stick for years to come for us. But now everyone else will remember this team and think about this team. This is a great team, and I'm very happy to be associated with it.
When you were 6-7, how did this change? What changed that led to this streak that leads all the way to one of the most dramatic Grey Cup wins ever?
Well, we learned a lot. You know, that was the bottom line. We never stopped working, never stopped believing in each other. We just had things to learn and things to figure out. And obviously a couple of guys that hop on board. But we never stopped working, never stopped believing in ourselves, and never stopped competing against one another. And that was what was so special about this group. If you ever watched us practice, you would see why there was a chance we'd be here tonight. And that's all you can control. You can't control anything else. You can control your belief, control how you work at something, and good things generally come. And so you just got to be patient at times, but they came.
Finally, what did you see in Cody Fajardo that others didn't?
Again, I'll tell you, he's a hard worker. He cares about football. He puts his heart and soul into it. And he's got all the attributes. I think belief in him is what he needs. I think it's no different than any quarterback. He needs someone to have confidence in him to kind of realize the next level. He's got all the talent. He works hard as anybody. He cares. You know, now we believe in him, and we'll see.
You won as a player, you won as a quarterback coach, you've now won as a head coach. I know you've been working on the French. Felicitas.
I appreciate that. Merci. Thank you.
The celebration at the podium continues for the Alouettes, and Jason Moss, first Grey Cup as a head coach. Cody Fajardo, first one as a starting quarterback, Len Suter. These are two that had tough times in Saskatchewan. Moss was fired. They didn't want Fajardo back. And look at them now. This has been quite a season, quite a finish for them.
Well, Jason Moss told us this week that three principles that they have preached all year long were your ability, that gets you here. That's why you're here. Your toughness mentally and physically. That is what defines this team, and your effort is what the rest of the world will notice. And they executed all of that. And in these post-game interviews, you heard every single player refer to the fact that they were playing for each other. This is the ultimate team sport. The Montreal Alouettes are Grey Cup champions because they played together and they played for each other.
And the way they did it will not be forgotten. Not only the upset of a 16-2 team to get here, but beating the Bombers, who won 14. And who will forget Tyson Philpott from Cody Fajardo? 19 yards and the winning Grey Cup touchdown. The Alouettes complete the Grade 8. Winning the CFL title game for the eighth time. We have lots more to come from the panels. Anthony Calvillo among the Alouettes still celebrating here in Hamilton. We'll be back.